Okay, you've squeezed into seat 14B and your flight has just taken off. Maybe once you reach cruising altitude, you can get half a can of Sprite or a little bag of party mix. You lean your head back and close your eyes for a moment. Suddenly, there's a loud explosion, a huge lurch, and the plane plunges to the left. Adrenaline pumping, your body is suddenly straining against the seatbelt. Will you be okay? Your fate is in the pilot's hands, and the reactions of the pilots will not just depend on their quick wits, but also on the design of the cockpit they're sitting in. The research that led to safer cockpit design is also the hidden force behind many of the things you do every day, from using your TV remote control to launching apps on your laptop to unlocking your iPhone. Let's get into it. This guy is Paul Fitz. Born in Tennessee in 1912, by the time he was 26, he had already completed a PhD in experimental psychology. Smart guy. He dreamed of settling down, of researching and teaching at a university. The only thing in his way? World War II. So Fitz joined the United States Air Force and ended up stationed at a military research lab in Ohio. His advanced degree in psychology was a rarity, and his superiors really didn't know what to do with him. So Fitz was asked to help solve a mystery that was befuddling the brass. Why were there so many seemingly perfectly good planes crashing, falling out of the sky for no clear reason? Conventional wisdom at the time was that these planes were crashing because of pilot error. And the evidence at first glance seemed to support it. Pilots, many of them young men learning on the job, were taking nonsensical actions, like coming in for a perfect landing, except with the landing gear still up, or misreading an instrument in clear weather and slamming their plane into the ground. Stuff like that, it just didn't make any sense. So the Air Force was pretty desperate to put a stop to these random accidents. They tried everything. They enhanced pilot training. They beefed up aircraft maintenance. They even let the pilots get more sleep. But none of it changed anything. Planes kept falling from the sky. And so, at their wit's end, the Air Force asked Paul Fitz and his team of erudite, fancy-pants psychologists to take a look at the problem and sent them the huge stack of accident reports. Now, psychologists are trained to spot patterns, and so pretty quickly Fitz's team noticed something interesting. These accidents weren't random. There were clear patterns in the data, the same mistakes happening over and over. Take, for one example, many reports of B-17 Flying Fortress bombers attempting to land without the landing gear down. Why would a pilot do this? Fitz sent his team to study the B-17 cockpit in detail, and they noticed something interesting. A section of the instrument panel with identical side-by-side toggle switches, one to control the flaps and the other to operate the landing gear. It turned out that at the end of a 10-hour bombing run, exhausted pilots sometimes flipped the wrong switch, intending to lower the flaps, but instead raising the landing gear. And you can't land a bomber very effectively without the wheels down. Fitz and his team discovered a pattern of accidents like this that seemed on the surface a lot like human error, but which were in fact something more interesting, design error. This was kind of a radical concept for the time, that the design of an object could cause human error. So they started experimenting with cockpit design, moving controls to more intuitive places, changing the shapes of the colors and tactile feel of switches and dials and levers. In a very real way, Fitz's team was inventing human factors engineering, the science of being aware of the impact of design on human performance. Now, all of this is probably already enough to put Fitz in the Designer Hall of Fame, but I haven't even gotten to the thing he's most famous for yet, so stay with me. The war ends, and Fitz settles down to teach psychology at Ohio State, but he keeps up his interest in aviation safety. He becomes fixated on how to make controls more intuitive, especially in stressful situations. Like, imagine piloting a fighter jet and you get hit. You might only have a few seconds to eject from the plane safely. That kind of thing. So, in 1954, he devised a set of clever tests. Subjects were asked to accurately and quickly tap a stylus between two metal plates. He moved the plates closer and further away from the test subjects and recorded their times as they tapped. Fitz discovered something fascinating. Both the size and the distance of the plates predicted how quickly people could tap them. As a plate moved further away, it became more difficult to tap it quickly. Same with size. Big plates easy to tap, small plates harder. This seems intuitive enough, but Fitz went a step further and turned this flash of insight into an equation. And thus, Fitz's law was born. Put simply, Fitz's law is a mathematical model for predicting human fine motor control performance. If you know how far away something is, and how large it is, you can predict how quickly a person can reach it. If you're designing an ejector seat for a fighter jet, for instance, put the handle near the pilot and make it big. The implications of Fitz's law go far beyond aviation. Think about your computer keyboard. The most used keys, like spacebar, enter, and delete, are larger than the rest of them. TV remote controls put play, pause, and rewind as close as possible to where your fingers naturally rest. The brake pedal in a car is larger than the accelerator. Dangerous factory machines have small buttons to turn them on and huge buttons to turn them off. Safety first. But to me, here's the most interesting thing. Though it was formulated in the physical world, Fitz's law has enormous implications for software. In fact, it's one of the guiding laws of user interface design. Here's a web page that recreates a version of Fitz's experiment on the screen, with red dots instead of metal plates, and your mouse as the stylus. The same relationships remain true, even though this is digital. Close and big is faster, far away and small is slow. Play with it yourself and check your results. I'll put a link in the description below. The key takeaway for software designers is clear. The farther away a control is from the user's position, the larger it needs to be to achieve the same average acquisition speed. Put another way, there are only two ways to improve efficiency. Put controls closer to where you're pointing, or make them bigger. Designers take advantage of this all the time. Navigation links on websites are made huge because they're further away from where you're reading. Context menus, on the other hand, place important commands as close as possible to your mouse cursor, also making them easy to click. Now, are you ready for the magic? Thought experiment time. Think about how easy it is to move your mouse pointer all the way across the screen, from the right side to the left edge. You can literally just slam your hand to the left as fast and as hard as you want, and you won't overshoot. In a Fitz's law sense, you can think of the edges of the screen as being infinitely wide. This ease of clicking screen edges is why the Mac user interface has been praised as having mile-high menus. Because it's permanently affixed to the top of the screen, clicking on a menu only requires targeting it in one dimension. There are countless other examples. The Windows taskbar is infinitely large in the other direction, as long as you keep it to one row of icons. Swiping up to unlock your iPhone is easy because you can swipe across the entire bottom edge. This requires much less precision than typing in a numeric code. But wait, it gets even better. There are four places on a computer screen that are effectively both infinitely wide and infinitely tall. Acquiring the corner requires very little fine motor control because the virtual target is so huge. In user interface terms, the corners are so good that they're often called magic. The start button in Windows, for instance, is in the ideal position. You can just slam your mouse into the corner to open the start menu. Really, same idea with the notification area in the upper right corner of macOS. Infinitely easy to click. If you pay attention, you'll see the impact of Paul Fitz's work everywhere you look. It impacts the way games are programmed to work with motion controllers. It's the reason why you can pound the entire steering wheel to honk your car's horn. It's why designers keep trying to make radial menus a thing. So that's Fitz's law, aviation research adapted to shape a model that influences the world designed around us, both physical and virtual. If you liked the video, it would be sumptuous if you consider subscribing. And take a screenshot of your subscriber number. You'll need that a bit later down the road. That's all for today. Thanks for watching.